Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's webinar, Employment Law Annual Checkup. My name is Karen Rasmussen, and I will be introducing our speakers, reviewing a few housekeeping items, and then we'll get the presentation started. First, to cover some logistics, this is a live streaming event, and there is no call-in number for this session. Attendees are tuned in on a listen-only mode, so simply turn the volume up on your computer or smart device. And depending on your browser, you should be seeing these boxes on your screen, and you may need to scroll down or to the right to see all of them. You can expand your slide area by clicking on that maximize icon on the top right of the slide area, or by dragging the bottom right corner. And while we will not be answering questions until the end of the webcast, time permitting, questions may be submitted anytime during the webcast by entering your question in that Q&A text field and clicking submit. I would also like to encourage you to complete our short survey by clicking on the checklist survey icon at the bottom of the screen. And a PDF of this presentation, along with additional resources you may find useful, are in the resource list next to the presentation slides. Lastly, for technical problems, please see the question mark help widget at the bottom of the screen. It's going to link you to Common Solutions, and using F5 to refresh your browser is usually a really good first thing to try. And if you are on some kind of company network or VPN, if there is any way you can temporarily log off of that, I would recommend that you do that as well. Now, today's webcast is certified for HRCI and CPE credit. And for CPE credit, ADP partners with Wolters Kluwer for our CPE learning program. And as a reminder, for those that want CPE credit, you will need to respond to the polling questions that we will have throughout the session to qualify. And specifically, you need to answer yes to the last polling question we will have on requesting CPE credit. And going to that link on the screen is going to let you manage all your courses and access your certificates. And for our HR practitioners, your HRCI credit information is going to be included in the thank you for attending email we send out after the event. And additionally, if you attend the event for at least 50 minutes today, that HRCI certificate is going to be made available using the certification widget at the bottom of the screen at the end of the live event today. And I'm going to quickly review our legal disclaimer. Today's presentation is not legal or tax advice, and before taking any actions on the information contained in this presentation, employers should review this material with their counsel. And keep in mind that what we're discussing today is not the final word on any of these topics, and nothing is intended to be a political opinion. And with that, I'd like to introduce today's speakers, Samantha Monroe and Kevin Skelly. Samantha is senior counsel with ADP, and prior to serving as in-house counsel, she was counsel with an AM 100 law firm specializing in employment law and represented employers in cases that involved, among other things, alleged wrongful termination, harassment, discrimination, wage and hour violations, and unfair business practices. Samantha regularly interacted with state and federal agencies, such as the U.S. Department of Labor and the EEOC, defending clients' interests at every stage of the compliant charge process, including investigations, audits, and administrative hearings. Kevin is an experienced corporate and employment in-house attorney on ADP's litigation team. In addition to handling litigation cases, he provides advice and counsel on a variety of labor and employment law topics. And prior to joining ADP, Kevin was a labor and employment attorney at a large law firm. So we thank you for joining us today. And Sam, I know both you and Kevin have a lot to talk about today, so I'm going to turn the event over to you to cover the agenda.
Thank you so much, Karen, and welcome, everyone. We've got a packed webinar for everyone today, and I'll start with just a brief overview of what we're going to cover. We've got compliance implications of a remote or hybrid workforce, data privacy considerations with remote employees, annual notice compliance considerations and automatic increases in minimum wage, state and local regulations related to COVID-19, including paid leave obligations, vaccine mandates, and finally, some key takeaways that everyone can consider. So back to you, Karen, with the first polling question.
Yes, thank you so much, Sam. So we are going to start the event off today with a polling question, which you should be seeing now on your screen. And our first polling question today is, does your company have future plans to change employees' work locations? And your possible answers are yes. We plan to move back to a majority of employees on site in the future. Or yes, we plan to adopt mostly or fully remote work policies in the future. We plan to have a majority of employees in a hybrid work arrangement in the future, or you are unsure. And I'm going to give my first CPE reminder for those of you that would like CPE credit to please make sure you respond to the question to qualify. I'm going to read it one more time. Does your company have future plans to change employees' work locations? Yes, plan to move back to majority of employees on site in the future. Yes, plan to adopt mostly or fully remote work employees policies in the future. Plan to have a majority of employees in a hybrid work arrangement, or you are unsure. I'm going to give you just a couple more seconds to answer. Okay. Sammy should be seeing the results on the screen now.
Sure do. So it looks like we've got quite a bit of folks planning to have a majority of employees in a hybrid work arrangement in the future, as well as planning to also move back a majority of those employees on site in the future. Definitely something that, you know, is expected and is actually the norm now. So let's dive right in. Today we're going to start out by taking a look at compliance considerations for remote or hybrid workforce, including topics for avoiding compliance pitfalls and remaining compliant without sacrificing productivity. As employers know, there's been an ever-changing landscape over the last couple of years as to how and where employees do work. Many employers have a remote or hybrid work setup for employees. Either the employees work entirely remote, or there might be a hybrid situation where they come in for a couple days to the office and remotely work the remainder of time. As we start 2022, many employers are either maintaining the remote work setup or moving employees to a hybrid setup, which is what we saw in that last polling we just did. And as data suggests, remote and or hybrid work arrangements may be here to stay. So let's figure out what we need to be aware of, what we need to watch out for, so we can continue and maintain being compliant. When an employer has remote or hybrid work arrangements, things can get a little complicated, to say the least. We're going to get into the topics displayed on this slide in a little more detail, but as a brief overview, I want to say and highlight the following. Where employees work remotely in a state that is different from the office location they were assigned to, the employee and in turn the employer may be subject to various additional state laws. Specifically, the employee and the employer may be subject to the laws in the state where the employee is performing their remote work. This can have an impact on tax and benefit issues, wage and hour, eligibility for FMLA, paid leave, workers' comp, and other areas. And let's not forget that where employers have previously allowed employees to work from home and are now requiring employees to work solely in the office or partly in the office, employers should expect an uptick in accommodation requests to remain remote. And we would suggest that the employers work with counsel or their trusted HR partner to work through those accommodation requests. Let's now turn our attention and dive a little deeper into how state and local employment laws can impact an employer where the employer uses remote and hybrid work. That is, how can an employee performing work in a state other than the office they're assigned to now require employers to follow the state and local laws where the employee is performing remote work? So let's start from the beginning. As everyone knows, there are federal employment laws such as Americans with Disability Act, Family Medical Leave Act, Title VII, Fair Labor Standards Act, and others that apply across the nation, so long as the employer is covered under such laws. However, the complexity arises when a remote worker works in a state other than the one they would otherwise work in had they come into the physical office. And that's where additional state and local laws from that state for remote workers performing work can apply. So what does this mean for employers with remote or hybrid workers? Well, it means that those employers need to keep an accurate accounting of where their remote workers are physically performing their work in order to know what additional state or local requirements may apply. Let's go ahead and turn to the first area where remote and hybrid work locations may have an impact. The first area I want to cover here is worker classification. And what I mean by that is classification as either an employee or as an independent contractor. As we know, determining whether a worker is truly a 1099 independent contractor versus a W-2 employee can sometimes get rather complicated. The federal standard to determine whether someone is an independent contractor involves looking at multiple factors to assess whether, among other things, the company has a level of control over the worker such that they should be classified as an employee. I'm not going to go through the economic realities test. I've just listed the factors to consider above for your reference, and you can refer back to them when you get a copy of our slide deck. You might be asking, though, how does the state where the remote worker is performing work come into play? Well, some states apply a different test than the economic realities test, which is the federal standard, to determine if a worker is an independent contractor or an employee. That means that even if the worker would be classified one way under the federal test I just showed you, the worker may be working in another state that has a different test altogether. That means the employer would need to look at both the federal test and any applicable state test in order to assess whether the employee is an independent contractor or an employee. So I have up here New Jersey as an example. Several states have what is known as the ABC test. And this test is really different, I mean, very, very much different than the federal test. And the starting point is a presumption that the worker that you're assessing is an employee. That's the assumption you're starting from. And it's only if all three factors set forth in this slide are met that the employer would conclude that the worker is an independent contractor. So you start with the presumption they're an employee. If you meet all of the three factors, then you can conclude that the worker is an independent contractor. Again, keeping a firm grasp on where workers are performing their work will help you maintain compliance in terms of properly classifying workers as independent contractors or employees. And as we all know, failure to properly classify can have dire legal consequences that none of us want. What else can be impacted in the wage and hour space? Well, one of those things can be calculation of overtime. We all know the federal standards set out by the FLSA, where employers are generally required to provide non-exempt employees overtime pay if they work over 40 hours in a work week. However, some states are even stricter in terms of calculating overtime than what the federal standard provides. For instance, some states actually require overtime if the employee works a certain amount of hours in a single day. That's right, overtime based on hours worked in a single day, very different than the FLSA. So some of these states include Alaska, California, Colorado, Nevada. So once again, and I'll keep hammering this, keeping track of which states remote and hybrid workers are performing their work is critical, as it certainly can impact overtime, among other things. Other areas of wage and hour can also be impacted by state laws separate and apart from what the federal standard requires. For instance, meal and rest breaks. Some states do not require meal and rest breaks, while other states require certain breaks, certain length of breaks, and frequency of breaks to be given. Pay requirements can also be impacted. Different states dictate how frequently you have to pay an employee and run payroll, as well as how quickly that final paycheck must be provided after separation of the employee from the company. In terms of vacation time, some states require that accrued vacation time be paid out at the time an employee separates from the company, while other states allow use it or lose it policies, meaning if an employee doesn't use the vacation time they've accrued by a certain date, they lose it, and employers may not have to pay out any unused accrued vacation time upon separation. State laws also differ in terms of salary thresholds needed to be classified as an exempt employee. So if the employee who would otherwise meet the salary threshold to be an exempt, to be exempt under the Fair Labor Standards Act, works in a state that has a higher salary threshold requirement, the employer will want to know this in order to avoid losing the exempt status of the employee and, again, facing potential serious legal consequences. One of the compliance pitfalls in the wage and hour space that employers face where non-exempt employees are working remotely on all or certain days is ensuring that off-the-clock work is not being performed and all-time work is being accurately recorded. With remote workers, as we know, they may feel like they're always on because there's no separation from work other than, as we know, moving from the office to the kitchen and back and forth. For non-exempt employees, this can create wage and hour issues if it's not properly monitored and addressed. So what should employers do? Department of Labor in 2020 did provide some guidance clarifying employers' obligations to track teleworkers' compensable hours. They clarified that work which is not requested by the employer, but the employer permitted, must be paid. Employers must pay for all hours worked that they know or have reason to believe were performed, which can be based on either actual knowledge or constructed knowledge. An employer can acquire such knowledge by establishing a reasonable process for employees to report uncompensated work. If the employer provides a mechanism to report any work that was not compensated for, and the employee just doesn't use it, the employer is likely not required to investigate further to uncover unreported hours. But the employer can't just bury their head in the sand. So, for instance, if the employer becomes aware that a non-exempt employee is sending out emails after hours or taking phone calls after hours and not reporting this time, the employer is going to be on notice that off-the-clock work is being performed. Sorry, let me go back. So some takeaways for our employers. What can we do to avoid some of these compliance pitfalls? First, we're going to want to have clear policies in place that non-exempt employees are to accurately report all hours and no off-the-clock work is permitted. Timekeeping can also be challenging for remote workers who do not have access to a company clock, time clock. Companies want to make sure that the employee's ability to log their time is unimpeded and there are no irregularities. Make sure a clear policy is in place that states that non-exempt employees are not to perform any work during their meal or their break time. As we know, non-exempt employees must be fully relieved of all work during meal and break times, and if they're not and they perform work, employers have to compensate for that time. Another complexity that the pandemic and remote or hybrid work arrangements has brought on is maintaining the exempt status from overtime under the FLSA for managers and supervisors. As we went over, non-exempt employees must be paid overtime for all hours worked over 40 in a single work week. However, if the employee performs certain duties, this may make them exempt from overtime so long as they're paid a certain minimum salary. One such exemption is for managers and supervisors who are paid a salary of at least $684 a week and perform certain duties, which are listed here, and I'm not going to read all of them, but one of them is regularly directing the work of at least two other full-time employees, among other things. Now, with the pandemic and remote and hybrid work arrangements, managers and supervisors' duties may have changed, and employers are actually seeing this quite a bit. So, for instance, managers and supervisors may have taken on higher-level work or other duties that now constitute the employee's primary duties due to the fact that the company may have a reduced workforce, and so duties had to shift. As a result, the employee's managerial or supervisory duties required by the FLSA to be exempt may have simply fallen to the wayside, and the employee may have lost their exempt status. Employers should be monitoring any changes in job duties very closely and ensuring that the employee's primary duties still consist of what is required by the FLSA in order to be exempt. And this applies to not just managers and supervisors, But any exempt employees, we'll want to make sure that those primary duties do remain the same. In addition, some state laws actually quantify the percentage of duties that the primary duties must make up in terms of the employee's overall work. So employees should look into whether any of their exempt employees, not only managers and supervisors, are performing work in a state with such requirements. Again, you know, you've got employees out working in various states. We want to keep abreast of that and see whether or not there's any complications regarding primary duties and the sort of percentage that that primary duty needs to be made up. Okay, what can we take away? I've highlighted a few things here, but one thing that I definitely want to emphasize, and I think most people on this call or on this webinar really know this, but just an abundance of caution, if an employee violates an employer's policy and performs unauthorized work and doesn't record that time, and the employer must compensate for that time but is able to discipline that employee. You just can't simply not compensate. Another area that can be impacted by where a remote or hybrid worker performs work outside of the office is eligibility for FMLA. An employer is covered under the FMLA if it employs 50 or more employees within a 75-mile radius of the employee's work site. When an employee performs work remotely, however, the question then becomes, where is the relevant 75-mile radius from? Is it the 75-mile radius determined from the person's home? Is it the company office? What is it? Determination of a remote worker's employee work site for FMLA eligibility is not, and I repeat, is not determined by where an employee performs the work or the employee's personal residence. Rather, it is the office that the employee reports to and from which assignments are made. This is something that employers see time and time again and may be applying that 75-mile radius incorrectly. But of course, state laws make it even a little bit more complicated, of course, and state leave laws apply based on the state where the employee performs the work. So we got to also take that into consideration. So that is, even if we determine whether the employer is covered under the FMLA by looking at the 75-mile radius from the office the employee reports and from which assignments are made, additional state requirements may come into play in terms of state leave. Specifically, the state the employee performs work in will determine which state leave laws apply, which may carry with them additional requirements. And I'll turn this back over to Kevin.
Thank you, Sam. And hello, everyone. We're going to talk right now about some tax and business issues surrounding the remote and hybrid workers. The work-from-home arrangements that have resulted from the pandemic have created payroll tax consequences for employers. The general rule is that payroll tax withholding follows the rules of the state where the work is performed. But this gets complicated in a hybrid work environment when employees work from different locations at different times. For example, in situations when an employee reports to an office a few days each week in state A, but then reports to work from their residence other days in state B. When employers permit employees to work remotely from a location other than the employer's location, the best practice is to conduct a tax compliance review. State laws follow different rules regarding tax withholdings. For example, some states say that if an employee works in a different state for more than a set number of days, the employer must make a change in the payroll reporting and begin submitting taxes to the state where the work is being performed. Other states follow different rules. So in short, it is a complicated issue, and it involves a detailed analysis and facts of each employee's work arrangement and applicable state tax laws. A one-size-fits-all solution is not sufficient because the circumstances vary for each employee who is working in a hybrid or remote work environment. So the best practice is to consult with a tax and legal professional to determine which laws apply to the employer's business and payroll reporting. Okay, we're going to summarize here a few takeaways from some of the recent topics we've been discussing. Employers should pay attention to the work location of their employees. State and employment tax laws differ in many ways. It's important for companies to ensure that their handbooks and policies are up to date. At the start of the new year, this is a really good time to review employee handbooks and policies to ensure that policies are updated and relevant, that the policies and handbooks reflect and apply to the remote work environment, and that handbooks contain certain state-specific information. Some employers, for example, use state-specific addendums in their handbooks to address unique legal rights under state law. And with that, I believe we move to the next polling question, Karen.
Thank you so much. Yes, correct. At this point, you should be seeing the second polling question on your screen. And our question, the second question today is, to the extent your company allows hybrid or remote work, does your company conduct audits of employees' location when they are working remotely or outside of the company office? So very straightforward answers for this. It's yes, you are, no, you are not, or you are unsure. And I'm going to give my second CPE reminder for those of you that would like credit to please make sure you respond to the question to qualify, and I'll read it one more time. To the extent your company allows hybrid or remote work, does your company conduct audits of employees' location when they are working remotely or outside of the company office? Possible answers again, very straightforward, yes. Your company is, no, your company is not, or you are unsure. I'm going to give you just a couple more seconds to respond. I see they're still, okay, looks like they kind of petered off coming in. Okay, Kevin, you should be seeing the results on the screen now.
Yes, thank you, Karen. Interesting results. Looks like most of the respondents have said no, which is not surprising to me. I know that this is a tricky issue in the remote work environment. Many employers really have no idea where their employees are working, and it's very difficult to sometimes find that information out. Okay. And with that, I will hand it back to Sam to talk about some workers' compensation issues.
Okay. Thank you so much, Kevin. Workers' compensation can also be impacted where employees are working off-site, away from the office, in their homes, or another location. So the areas just don't stop. Here's another area that's impacted by the states those remote workers are working. Just generally, by way of background, workers' comp generally compensates for injury or illness that takes place within the period of employment, where an employee may reasonably be, and while the employee is reasonably fulfilling the duties of employment. So what should employers be mindful of as it relates to remote or hybrid workers in relation to workers' comp? Employers should establish guidelines such as a designated work area and perhaps some training for those remote workers. They may also want to set fixed hours and meal break periods. So this is going to assist in establishing whether the injury was in the course of employment, which certainly is helpful in defending against a workers' comp claim. And with that, Kevin, if you could take us through the next portion.
Thank you, Sam. So we are moving now to the second section in our presentation today, which is data privacy considerations with remote employees. Now, this can be a scary topic because it can cause employers some serious concern and create significant risk for any organization. And we have all seen and heard of these news reports about organizations being hit with ransomware attacks and other types of security breaches. Unfortunately, these incidents appear to be more and more common every year. The pandemic and the shift to a remote work environment has only increased the severity of these data security incidents. And there are a few reasons for this, such as the growing number of employees who are working remotely from an unsecured remote network connection. It is essential that employers maintain physical, electronic, and procedural safeguards to protect their confidential information and data. And data security incidents not only pose a risk to an organization's confidential information and business operations, but they also trigger reporting and notification requirements under state privacy laws. Now that we've identified the risks associated with data privacy issues, let's now talk about a few ways that employers can prevent being the victim of some type of data security incident. Make sure that employees are trained on proper security procedures. Also, create a mechanism for employees to report security concerns, such as suspicious emails. Employers are generally very good about implementing physical security protections to protect information in the office. For example, many employers use badge access to enter an office building. They have security guards in the office. They put locks on file cabinets and doors. And these are all very good security measures to have in place. But just as important as these physical security measures are the ways that organizations can protect their network and data stored on company equipment. These additional security measures include things like requiring passwords to access equipment and data sources, the use of encryption, and policies against sending confidential information through unsecured means. Another way that companies can protect their confidential information is through the use of employment agreements, particularly non-disclosure agreements with employees. As part of the annual employment law checkup, I recommend that employers review their non-disclosure agreements to ensure that those agreements are robust and comply with applicable state and federal laws. Non-disclosure agreements serve a number of important functions for employers, including these agreements put employees on notice of what information the company considers confidential. Also, these agreements create a legal cause of action if the employee or former employee breaches the agreement by misusing confidential company information. And for employees who are working remotely, it is important that the organization has a way to obtain employee acknowledgments on the agreement, for example, through an electronic acknowledgment process. We're going to shift now to a different topic, monitoring of workers. With so many employees working remotely, employers are often concerned that workers are not fully engaged and not working consistently throughout the workday. Employers may be tempted to monitor employees to ensure that they are actually working when they say they are. Some employers have used software that tracks computer keystrokes or other types of software to monitor their employees. The important point here is that there are laws and privacy concerns with monitoring employee activity in the workplace. Employers should proceed with caution before engaging in monitoring of employee activity. Employers are encouraged to consider alternatives other than monitoring to ensure that employees are meeting the expectations of the job. Set clear expectations for work hours and responsibilities of the role, and communicate those expectations regularly to the employee population. Here are some general takeaways on this topic of employee monitoring. Put employees on notice of any monitoring. This is really the key. Make it clear that employees have no reasonable expectation of privacy while using company equipment or working on a company network. Make sure that there is a legitimate business reason for any monitoring. Don't monitor just because you have the ability or the means to do it. Organizations should balance the interests of the employers to protect its information and resources, and also the employees' expectation of privacy in the workplace. not all areas in the workplace are considered equal in terms of employee expectation of privacy. For example, an employee can legitimately expect a greater degree of privacy in their workstation or locker room compared to the main lobby entrance to the building where people are constantly coming and going. Ensure that monitoring is applied equally and does not target employees based on any particular protected class. And lastly, for any unionized workforces, employers should also be careful to comply with any collective bargaining obligations in advance of any monitoring. And with that, I think we move to our next polling question, Karen.
Apologies, there, I was on mute. I thought I was unmuted. Okay, so at this point, you should be seeing the third polling question on your screen. And if you're having any issues, it looked like there may have been a problem with the second polling question, so feel free to respond in the Q&A box if for some reason you're not seeing an option here. But you should be seeing the third question on your screen. And at this point, it is, does your company monitor remote workers or workers that work sometimes outside of the company's office to ensure work is being performed? Straightforward answers like last time, it's yes, we are, no, we are not, or you are unsure. I'm going to read the question one more time. I'll also give my CPE reminder for those of you that would like CPE credit to please make sure you respond to the question to qualify. The question is, does your company monitor remote workers or workers that sometimes work outside of the company's office to ensure work is being performed? Your possible responses are yes, no, or you are unsure. I'm going to give a few more seconds because I see responses still coming in. Just a couple more. Okay, Kevin, you should be seeing the results on the screen now.
Yes, thanks, Karen. Okay, well, the majority have said no. And I'm not surprised by those results. Perhaps that might indicate that employers are confident in their remote employees that are doing the job well. But also it might indicate that employers understand that there are some serious considerations in place before any monitoring occurs. Okay, we're going to move on. We're moving now to the next section in our presentation, which is the annual notice compliance considerations and automatic increases in the minimum wage. Okay, both federal and state laws require employers to provide employees with certain notices relating to employee rights and employer obligations under various laws. There are also laws that require employers to post certain notices in a prominent place in the workplace. The number of posters and notices seems to increase every year. The company bulletin board is getting filled up with these types of notices and posters. Failure to comply with the notice posting requirements can lead to fines and other penalties for employers. The specific notices that must be distributed and posted vary by state and location, but some of the typical notices include things like state discrimination and retaliation laws, state leave of absence laws, wage payment obligations, disability and unemployment insurance, and workers' compensation. Now, this topic of notice posting is fairly straightforward. But in the remote work environment, there's a new layer of complexity to this issue. The main point here is that the shift to a remote or hybrid work environment does not eliminate the need to comply with notice posting requirements in the workplace. The Federal Department of Labor has issued guidance for employers for how to comply with department notice posting requirements in a remote workplace. For employers who have some workers working remotely and others working in the office, the department recommends posting through both a hard copy and electronic means. If a law requires continuous posting of a notice, the Department of Labor will allow for electronic posting only under certain conditions, specifically if all employees exclusively work remotely, employees customarily receive information from the employer through electronic means, and if employees readily have access to the electronic posting at all times. As a practice tip here, when in doubt, it's best to err on the side of over-communicating and over-posting of these notices and policies. Okay, moving now to another topic, the minimum wage considerations. And we're not going to spend much time on this topic. I think everyone sort of understands the basics about minimum wage laws. But I would like to note that many states have been increasing their minimum wages to a much higher level than the federal minimum wage level. When a state minimum wage is higher than the federal level, all employers must comply with the applicable state and local minimum wage law. Many states increase their state minimum wage level on an annual basis, oftentimes in January. So now is a good time for employers to double check that they are complying with the recent updates to the minimum wage levels in each jurisdiction. This slide identifies the various jurisdictions that have recently increased their minimum wage. And as you can see, many states have minimum wages that now far exceed the federal rate of $7.25 per hour. So employers should regularly monitor the minimum wage laws to ensure compliance. And with that, I will hand it back to Sam.
Thank you, Kevin. The next topic we are going to cover is state and local regulations related to COVID-19, and this includes paid leave obligations and vaccine mandates. I want to preface this section by saying that I will not be going into the slides individually. The slides set forth some of the bigger state leave laws and local leave laws that have taken effect recently, but they're not exhaustive. We do have folks from all across the nation on this call today, so going into specific state requirements in a detailed manner may not be all that helpful. I did, however, want to provide you with the material in this slide deck, so once you receive the slide deck, you can review at your leisure. I will also highlight again, and you keep hearing me say it, that knowing what state or local paid leave obligations apply within not only the state's employees are performing work in the office, but also in remote settings are crucial in order for the employer to ensure that they are meeting any obligations or requirements that apply. So you're going to see me skip over some slides, and but like I said, since we have folks from all across the nation here, I just want to provide the materials and you can review at your leisure. I do want to go over, though, California requiring COVID-19 supplemental paid sick leave. Again, this has been a hot topic. I am sure everybody is aware of it. But I wanted to just spend some time to kind of go through this because this has been a difficult area to traverse. So California has enacted legislation that applies to California employees who work for employers that have at least 26 employees, with at least one of those employees working in California. The legislation requires covered employers to provide up to 80 hours of COVID-19 supplemental paid sick leave to California employees for certain circumstances, which are outlined in the slide. So you'll see there are a number of bullet points. Those are the reasons that you can take this supplemental paid leave. So I won't read them to you, but I just wanted to point out where that was. The COVID-19 supplemental paid sick leave requirement is effective February 19th, 2022, so that has passed. And it's actually retroactive to January 1st, 2022, and will remain in effect through September 30th, 2022. It may sunset at that time, or it may be extended. We don't know, but we will certainly keep everyone abreast. So for employees who work 40 hours or more, or maybe they don't work 40 hours, but the employer does deem them full-time, the employer has to provide up to 40 hours of COVID-19 supplemental paid sick leave for certain events. And those are those bullet points that I outlined there. Also, the employer must provide an additional bucket of 40 hours if the employee or a family member who the employee is providing care for tests positive for COVID-19. For both banks of leave, part-time employees, it's a little different, are entitled to amount of leave equivalent to the total number of hours they are normally scheduled to work over 1 week. If they have variable schedules, there are different rules and requirements for them, which I will not go into detail here, but I do want to make you aware of them. Generally, there's a lot of moving parts on this one, including pay statement requirements, where you have to display certain information on the pay statement, which was not the case before as it relates to the supplemental paid sick leave. So if you have employees in California, I want you to make sure to discuss this with your counsel or your trusted HR business partner so you can make sure that you are maintaining compliance. So one of the state paid leave trends, and even unpaid leave trends, is an expansion of the definition of family. So the FMLA, the Family Medical Leave Act, allows for, among other things, eligible employees who work for covered employers, those employers who actually the FMLA applies to them, to take leave to care for the employee's family member who has a serious health condition. But the definition of family member in the FMLA is limited, and it's limited to the employee's spouse, their son, daughter, or parent. But several states have expanded that definition of family for state leave laws. And we anticipate this trend to follow. And I will go over a few, just as some examples, of recent ones that have been enacted or will be enacted. So Maine now includes grandparents under their family medical leave laws and allows an employee to take unpaid leave to care for a grandchild or domestic partner's grandchild. So this was a big change. In Illinois, a covered family member means an employee's child, stepchild, spouse, domestic partner, sibling, parent, mother-in-law, father-in-law, grandchild, grandparent, or step-parent. That's quite a bit, and this is quite a deviation from the FMLA. It also permits employees to use their personal sick leave benefits to attend to the personal care of a covered family member. And what that personal care means is defined in the law. And you can look to that to get the exact definition on that. Washington now includes an individual who regularly resides in the employee's home or where the relationship creates an expectation that the employee cares for the person and that individual depends on the employee for care. California, family now includes spouse, registered domestic partner, parent, child, which includes an adult child, and a child of a registered domestic partner, grandparent, grandchild, and siblings. And so in New York, effective January 1st, 2023, so we've got a little bit of time, siblings will be included. So Karen, I'm gonna turn it back over to you for...
Yes, thank you, Sam. At this point, you should be seeing the final polling question on your screen. And as you see, this is the question we have on certification for the event today, which is, are you a CPA needing continuing professional education CPE credit? Now, before you select yes, if you're an HR professional and you're looking for a certificate of course completion, such as HRCI, you can select no to this question, and then please use that certification widget at the bottom of the screen at the end of the event today to download an HRCI certificate. And additionally, the HRCI information is also going to be included in the thank you for attending email. But if you're specifically looking for CPE credit, please submit yes. and you will be submitted for CPE credit for today's event. And no worry if you missed a polling question. We will, you said something in the Q&A, we will make sure that we have the credit recorded. So I'm going to give you all just a few more seconds to respond, because I still see some responses coming in. Let me give just a few more seconds. Okay, I'm going to move on. And I'm going to turn it back to you, Sam.
Thank you so much, Karen. I really appreciate that. So let's talk a little bit about some final takeaways. This was a lot of information in a short amount of time, and I completely understand that this probably will take, people will want to review the slides, but I want to summarize some of the main takeaways that I want folks to be aware of. So remain aware of changes in worker location. Right? We went through this before, but we want to really keep abreast of where folks are located when they are performing remote work, whether that's a hybrid work arrangement or a completely remote work arrangement, either which way. So employers will want to revise policies to require employees to notify the organization of any proposed change in location. So what I want to point out, though, here is similar to policies which state it is the employee's duty to keep HR informed of where they're located in terms of address, I really wouldn't rely upon this, because it's really going to be on the employer to make sure that they know where the employees are, because there's all sorts of state requirements that may come into effect, right? So the other thing that we want to look at is evaluate how state laws where remote and hybrid workers are working. This can impact employer requirements and employee rights, as well as how the state laws can impact any federal law requirements. In addition, be aware of wage and hour pitfalls with remote and hybrid workers. Pay close attention to any changes in duties stemming from remote hybrid work and how that may impact exempt employees. Make sure to create and implement policies in an effort to guard against potential wage and hour claims. So with that, I want to take, I'm going to take a question from the audience. And the question is there a legal requirement to post salary range when you post a position on Indeed or a company website? Again, this is going to be very state specific or local, based on local law. For instance, New York City has a law which requires, in certain circumstances, and there's nuances, where the salary range of a position that's open for hire or promotion must be disclosed. And it's what the employer reasonably believes what that salary range would be. And so the employer just, for instance, they couldn't get away with saying, all right, well, the minimum salary is X, and not put a max on there. They actually have to put numbers, the minimum and the maximum. In addition, there's requirements for displaying benefits. You actually have to state the benefits. One can't just say you get medical benefits, et cetera. That definitely won't work. One of the other questions that that we've received are, can employers restrict which states the remote employees work in? Well, I mean, sure, right? There's nothing exactly, you know, preventing remote work, you know, from, you know, you requesting remote workers, you know, stay within, you know, a certain area. But that's really going to be hard to do in a policy and really hard to do in a way that you're applying that policy, you know, across the board evenly. So in practical respects, I think that's going to be definitely difficult to do. Kevin, I think you also had some other takeaways that you wanted to add.
Yes, thanks, Sam. I think the one area that I'd like to just circle back on and just to further emphasize, because this is such a critical area for all companies and employers, is really on data privacy, right? And focused on how important it is that companies have right procedures in place, right? And I think as part of their annual employment law checkup, I'd recommend that companies take a look at their security procedures and make sure that they're updated and that employees that are working in a remote work environment, that they are working securely, right, and that they're accessing the network in a secure fashion, that they're changing their passwords regularly, and that they're not putting the company's data and information at risk. And I think we have all seen the news reports, and we know the consequences for employers when their data gets leaked and gets put on the internet or some other, you know, public place. So I think that's really an important takeaway for me, is make sure that employers really make sure that they have really strong security procedures in place to protect their information.
Okay, thank All you right. so much. I know we're at the top, but we're getting to the top of the hour. So I want to thank everyone for joining us today. We had a lot of questions come in, and I apologize if we're not able to get to them all. But please keep an eye out on our Spark Thought Leadership blog. We will definitely try to answer some of your questions there as well. And with that, this does conclude our session today. And as a reminder, your HRCI credit information is going to be included in that thank you for attending email. And if you completed the instructions for CPE credit, you should be able to access your credit using the instructions in the presentation within 24 to 48 hours. And to receive ongoing communications from ADP on regulatory and legislative guidelines and deadlines, please subscribe to our Eye on Washington email alerts by visiting the link shown on the screen or indicate you'd like to opt in on the event survey. I can tell you we do address many of the state-level paid leave that was discussed today. And in addition, you should be seeing in the resource list a link to our latest state and local and federal Eye on Washington as well. And for more workforce trends and insights, we encourage you to visit our Spark blog link that I just referred to earlier shown on the screen. And lastly, you can register for additional webinars, such as our March 16th webinar we are having on pay equity and equal pay, strategic and compliance considerations in Canada and the U.S. And you can do that using the link shown on the screen as well. So again, on behalf of Sam and Kevin and myself and the entire team at ADP, we thank you for joining us today, and we look forward to having you join us for future events. I want to thank you again, and I hope everyone out there continues to stay safe.